Kevin's play impressed me more than Jim's play with that deck. I think Kevin is just at home with playing decks like this, even if, you know, if you handed these players 100 different decks and said who played them better on the balance, I would probably go with Jim.
Kevin out there. Kevin's already dabbing.
Yeah.
Jim, I'm not sure if Jim even knows how to dab at this point. Maybe no. It's rubbed off. It's unclear. For me, you know, every player in this tournament has a story. That's what makes this tournament so great. They've gotten here in many different ways, and everyone has a different story. That's what makes competition so great. For Kevin, you know, I think about a couple of years ago when we heard the name of, you know, he's doing the IQ grind to work his way here. And it's like, okay, well, you know, he's winning a lot of his local tournaments. How good is this guy? Well, you know what? Over the past, at least for me, 7 or 8 months, he's proven he's gotten pretty darn good.
Yes. Maybe his range is a little bit limited. Maybe he isn't an expert of playing every single deck in every single format, but Delver of Secrets in Legacy and in Modern, I think Kevin is about as good as anyone.
Jim started things off with a Deathrite Shaman off of a Underground Sea. For Kevin, he's got Underground Sea of his own. He'll play a Thought Seize. Jim will daze. Kevin will daze back. This is the name of the game in Legacy. The interaction is plentiful.
Yes, it's very cheap, and it oddly slows the game down in a way that doesn't really happen in Modern. Because players are destroying each other's lands and countering spells for no mana.
Yeah.
Slows the game down a little bit.
The Thought Seize will resolve. You see Davis's hand. The Underground Sea's back in the grip. A Polluted Delta and Misty Rainforest, along with the Delver of Secrets and a Dark Confidant.
Would imagine with Davis here just threatening a turn to Dark Confidant off the Deathrite Shaman, that card's got to go. If that's in play for several turns, even if Jones does eventually answer it, Davis will just accrue a huge advantage.
Kevin taking notes about what's in Jim's hand.
You can see Brainstorm plus Abrupt Decay. So he can answer the threat. The question is, does he care more about the damage from Delver of Secrets or the card advantage from Dark Confidant?
Davis will draw a copy of Tarmogoyf.
Oh, that is about perfect.
Yeah.
Already a 3-4 here if he casts it this turn off the Deathrite Shaman. Potential to go to 4-5 next turn, and Jones with nothing in play.
Davis wanted to protect that Dark Confidant, hence the daze. And Jones dazed back, but it was a big draw step there for Davis, just to get the tournament started there with the timely Tarmogoyf. Now Davis is going to sacrifice Polluted Delta. He'll fall down to 19. Tropical Island is the weapon of choice, and I think we're going to see the Tarmogoyf here in just a moment.
Yeah, it's a great draw there for Davis.
Defending Player's Champion. And obviously, we've seen Jim a lot over the course of this year and last year as well. And as someone who is such a competitor like Davis is, you know how much that win meant to him last year and how much it changed his Magic career and his life. But I think that just with how Jim is from a competition standpoint, he wants to prove that last year was not a fluke.
Yes. You know, he had a great run in the tournament. But you don't want to be known as someone who just made some good metagame calls and won the whole thing. Mm-hmm. I think Davis wants to prove that this was no fluke. And it's also got to feel good for him to be here with two of his teammates. I mean,
they
collectively, this group of players, put in a lot of work. The Jessup brothers, Jim Davis, Kevin Jones, Peter Ingram now working at Wizards of the Coast. Very good 2016 for metagame gurus.
Jones with just an Underground Sea. He passes the turn back over to Davis. Davis will draw. Now he'll sacrifice a Misty Rainforest. Picked up an Abrupt Decay for his draw step. See what land he wants to dig out of the deck, and he will go with in Underground Sea.
You know, it has been a bit since I've seen these cards in play. I've got to say.
Yeah, I don't really know the last Legacy tournament you covered.
But it has been a bit.
Yeah. Tarmogoyf's going to come across here for 4.
Fortunately, I've seen these before.
Yes, so yes.
I'm familiar with what's going on.
This isn't new to you.
Yeah.
A Delver of Secrets will be played. And now Jones on Davis's instep will play a Brainstorm. The first of many, I'm sure, today, as he'll draw 3 cards and put 2 back here in just a moment.
Confirming Jim Davis player slide with Saltite Delver, nothing else.
A little interesting there that Jones elected not to brainstorm a response, because that Delver of Secrets feels good enough to even Force of Will at this point.
Just because he's so far behind?
Yeah. I mean, when you fall behind in the Delver Mirror match, it's pretty challenging to catch up, especially Jim now kind of has him coming from a bunch of different directions. He can trump Jones with size via the Tarmogoyf, and he has Evasive Threats and the Delver of Secrets and sort of the Deathrite Shaman.
Jones will sacrifice, at least try, to sacrifice Floodstrand. Worried about Stifle, of course. Chop Glion he put back from Brainstorm, so he'll put that directly in play off the top of his deck. And I think Abrupt Decay will be coming here in just a moment. A very real question on what you're supposed to target, though, between Tarmogoyf and Deathrite Shaman.
I'm guessing it has to be the Tarmogoyf here just because of the speed of the clock.
Okay.
For a turn versus two. Especially now with the second instant in the graveyard, Davis can remove one of those with the Deathrite Shaman and not shrink the Tarmogoyf.
Jones will pass. Davis with an Underground Sea and an Abrupt Decay in hand. Here's a Deathrite Shaman activation. Gotta remove something. And it looks like it'll be Brainstorm from Jones's graveyard. That's an exile now. And now here is the Abrupt Decay. Take care of the Tarmogoyf.
You can see Jones with a Delver of Secrets in his own hand, which is in theory an answer for Davis's. And then the Deathrite Shaman, maybe you find your own Deathrite Shaman, or you have a lot of time to find removal. Or maybe you just waste land Davis off of black mana. There's a lot of different outs, but the Tarmogoyf's just too fast right now.
Well, another Tarmogoyf has shown up. The Delver did not transform into Insectile Aberration, which was nice for Jones. However, the draw step was a nice one there for Davis and Tarmogoyf, so the 4-5 is back. Jones draws a very late Force of Will. Kevin will play a Brainstorm to start his turn. And that will resolve. So three cards on the way. One is a Scalding Tarn. Two looks to be another land. And three is another Abrupt Decay. Well, what Kevin needs right now is he needs to hope that Delver never flips, I think.
I mean, he's piecing together some answers here. The issue is just it's coming from a lot of different directions. And the best thing that he can do is answer a thing a turn. And he needs to do a lot better than that to stabilize this game.
Polluted Delta is what Jones will sacrifice. And he'll hope that it's good to go. Again, worried about Stifle when both players are playing with Perfect Information. Davis has Stifles in his deck. He's got three in his main deck. Jones knows that, so he's going to be as careful as he reasonably can be. And Fetch is still on the stack. Jim? He's going to do some posturing here. And he might activate Deathrite Shaman right away. It appears that he will.
I'm guessing the motivation for this is he's aware of the Gurmag Angler that Jones has access to.
Sure.
And he wants to cut off Jones before he regains priority and then can cast the Angler on the cheap.
Because Angler's good right now.
Yep.
Makes a lot of sense.
I know Davis has a reputation for slow play. And that looks like a kind of a, you know, he's just doing it for the sake of doing it. No, mm-hmm. There's a real reason. They have access to each other's deck lists. And making Gurmag Angler cost more, a high priority for Davis right now.
Abrupt Decay will take care of Tarmogoyf yet again. And now, as Jones is at 7, he needs that Delver not to transform. But there are a lot of great draw steps here for Jim Davis.
I mean, even any creature, Wasteland's good. Mm-hmm. He really needs it to be, you know, fetch lands and tropicals and underground seas.
Well, that was step one.
Okay.
Yeah. It was an underground sea, so Delver's going to come across for 1. Jones is going to fall down to 6.
And Davis is on, still Abrupt Decay left over, so mm-hmm. Not on empty. But
there's a way here for Jones. It's going to take some really good draw steps and some misses from Jim, but there's a way here for Kevin.
I think it goes beyond perfect draw steps at this point. I think it's things like perfect brainstorms and perfect ponders
okay. Into
sets of cards. But Jones is not on a 0%er here. If he can find an answer to the Delver and the Deathrite Shaman, he's in the clear. That's asking a lot here.
Mm-hmm.
And he can't be a blocker because Davis has Abrupt Decay left over. But not a 0%er.
Jones's draw is a Wasteland.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to play the Delver of Secrets. And now he'll play the Wasteland.
While I was on my way walking over to the booth, I saw Jacob Vaugh and Jerry Thompson squaring off, and they started off the game with wasteland each other's wasteland, and then someone's play on turn two was another wasteland and a pass, and I could not contain my excitement.
anything to make you happy.
This is the format I remember.
Here's an Abrupt Decay to take care of the Delver of Secrets. Jones with a Force of Will and a Volcanic Island. Now he'll wasteland here And perhaps he wanted to do that in reverse order, maybe? Wasteland the Tropical first and then play the Delver?
Yeah, probably better operations that way. Not that it matters too much in the scheme of things.
Not a ton.
You know, the Delver flips and Davis can activate the Deathbred Shaman the same way.
Yep. So, Jim Davis is going to win game number one here over Kevin Jones. Saltai Delver up a game here over four-color Delver. Jim Davis, with some careful play, some timely draw, sees himself up a game here to kick off our first day and our first round of competition.
I'm excited to go to the sideboards because Jim is known for having a couple pet cards in his Saltai Delver sideboards, including one of my favorites, a Winter Orb.
He
did not disappoint this weekend.
We will take a look at the sideboards here for both players, and we will start off with Kevin Jones as he'll be on the play. It's two Pithy Needle, a Diabolic Edict, two Fluster Storm, a Corrosion Grip, a Murderous Cut, a Life in the Loam, a Painful Trues, a Thought Seize, three Surgical Extractions, an Umezawa Shite, and a Leovold, Emissary of Trest. The thing for Kevin is if he can get this game to be a lot of turns, I think he's got the edge.
Yes, and when we look at Davis's sideboard, we can see Davis is better suited to play a resource-light game. Jones better to, if both players have a lot of resources to work with, Jones's deck is a little bit better set up. I think the one copy of Murderous Cut is a great include here. I think the Diabolic Edict is as well. He could go to the Loam plus Wasteland plan. I don't mind that when Jones is on the play here. A little bit more likely he can get that set up.
For Jim Davis, he's got the Winter Orb. He's got a Pith Needle and a Nullrod, two Baleful Strix, a Dread of Night, a Disfigure, a Dismember, a Force of Will, two Surgical Extractions, a Maelstrom Pulse, and Marsh Casualties, and two Thought Seizes. For Jim, and again, he's working with the perfect information of what Kevin can bring to the table, I think he's just got to be the aggressor here. Can't really win a long game.
I still think that you want to play with cards that are good for resource-like games, like this is likely to be. I think the one copy of Dismember and the one copy of Disfigure, even though they're reactive, are still so cheap and so efficient that they're worth bringing in. I also like the two copies of Baleful Strix a lot in this matchup. A lot of the matchup is just about raw card count, card advantage. Baleful Strix also happens to be a reasonable answer to Gurmag Angler as well, so I would anticipate those cards coming in.
He's got to win, I feel like, with a Delver Deathrite start.
Davis is definitely, if we're playing in the Wasteland days, who plays a better lean game, I think Davis's deck is much better than Jones. But if the game doesn't go that way, and it's who has better lock pieces, who has just more impactful cards, I think Jones can get an edge there.
All right. Well, that gives you an idea what both players are working with. Kevin Jones will be on the play here for game number two. And in the meantime, we're going to talk about the StarCityGames.com weekly sale that is taking place right now. You can over to the website and get up to 50% off of some pretty sweet standard singles right now.
Absolutely. Head over to the website, StarCityGames.com. Every week there's a weekly sale that runs from Monday, 11 o'clock Eastern Time, throughout the entire week. New sale every week, so make sure you're coming back to the website at least once a week to check out what's going on. And right now, up to 50% off select standard singles.
Got some Marvel, some Kozilek, some lands, and of course, Chandra, Torch of Defiance, StarCityGames.com. Head over there, check out the weekly sales. We get ready here for game number two between Jim Davis and Kevin Jones. Jim Davis currently up a game. What's interesting to me, again, as I said at the beginning of this match, every player has a different story.
Mm-hmm.
For Kevin, it's a player who has grown a lot over the past couple of years, and we've seen some players go through some real growth. For Jim, he's someone we've known for a while, both of us. Probably 10 years at this point,
yep.
Like we've both known him.
Jim, I've known for longer.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I think I met him when I was 18 or 19 at a Grand Prix. I'm 30 now, so maybe more than 10 years. But for Jim, you know, winning the Player Championship was a culmination of a lot of hard work last year. But I just know that it meant so much to him. Not to say that it wouldn't mean a lot to anybody, but, you know, he was thinking about transitioning out. Mm-hmm. Winning the Player Championship kept him into Magic. And it's really been worth it.
Yeah, I mean, you can have these moments as a competitive Magic player when, you know, the trophies elude you of, what am I doing here? Why am I committing this kind of time and energy? And I know that Jim was hitting that point in his life where he was questioning, is this worth my energy? Is this worth the commitment? Could I be doing other things with my time? And then came here to the Players Championship and had a bit of an upset, won the whole thing. And that reinvigorated him, not only his career, but the career of his teammates as well, mm-hmm. because he's taken his captainship of this organization very, very seriously.
And it's interesting because Jim's numbers this year, they're obviously good, but I believe in season 3, he lost playing for top 8 of 3 opens in a row and almost also playing top eight of the Invitational Atlanta, which he made the top four of. So those numbers could be even better. I know we've talked a lot, and we will over the course of this weekend, of what a great year Tom Ross, the SCG Tour Player of the Year, has had. What a great first season Jerry Thompson had to qualify for this tournament. What a great overall year Jeff Hoagland's had. But Jim Davis has had a great year too.
Yep, and you can just tell when Jim is locked in, there's just a different atmosphere at the table, a different way that he plays the game. You know, I think Jim, it's important for him to feel like the pursuits in his life, he does them well. I don't think he enjoys being mediocre at things.
No.
So he's either got to be in or out, was approaching out. But last year changed that trajectory quite a bit, and now returns here as the defending champion.
It was picture-perfect metagaming for Jim last year. Great play came along with it, because it has to in order to win a tournament like this. But picture-perfect metagaming from Davis. And to see him on Salty Delver, playing it more conventional. You know, we might see some players take a risk here in Legacy, but for Jim, he's just playing what he's always played. And maybe Legacy is a format where you just play with what you're comfortable with.
It could be. I mean, I think that the standard metagame is a little bit more in flux right now. That's worth a lot of commitment and time, and there's only so many hours you can devote to playtesting. So at certain points, you have to say, all right, I'm comfortable enough with this deck. You can't go that wrong. There's no metagame you show up with Salty Delver where you say, that was an awful choice. Maybe some metagames are better than others, but your cards are always going to work on a baseline, and you've only got so much time to work with.
Well, these two players will be getting ready to play here in just a moment. Of course, when we got some results for you guys, we will let you know. We've got every other match taking place right now. The results you can also find over on Twitter at SCG Live. Make sure you give that a follow. Hashtag SCGPC all weekend long for what should be a heck of a tournament and a lot of great moments. We can tell you that Caleb Shear with Storm, he won game one against Max McVitie, who is playing Infect here this weekend. So we have seen Max a little bit in Legacy, but he is playing Infect, and no surprise with Caleb.
No, not at all.
Looks like Jacob Baugh is playing lands, and he's taking game one against Jerry Thompson, who is playing Grixis Control. And Jeff Hoagland playing Alluren.
Of course. Of course. Alluren.
He wins his match against Todd Anderson, 2-0. Todd Anderson playing Sneak and Show, a deck that Todd has played a lot.
Loves to jam.
Yes, he does. We know coming into this, and Jeff would readily admit this, he's a pretty honest guy, he knows that Legacy is his blind spot. So for him to get a win on the board against Todd, that's a great start to his tournament.
Absolutely.
Kevin Jones, Jim Davis, they'll keep their opening hands. For Jones, he'll start things off with an Underground Sea. For Davis, he's got a wasteland. I know what you're thinking.
You don't know what Kevin has planned with that land over there. Could be anything.
Might be time to let it
Why
rip.
Why risk it? Although typically with Wasteland, you want to wait until you have an advantage on the battlefield, or at least advantage with mana. Usually Wastelanding on the draw, it can be fine in certain spots. And these decks are land light enough that you can hope that he just can't function in the face of this.
Well, Jim's got a second Wasteland too, so Jim's going to let the first Wasteland rip.
Mm.
Now, here's a Scalding Tar. Not the best thing to Wasteland. Though, interesting, because Kevin does open himself up a little bit to getting stifled here.
But if he sacks it, then he opens himself to getting Wastelanded.
Yes, he does.
And does Jim still have stifles in his deck on the draw? Who knows?
A very real question. For Davis, he's going to sacrifice a Misty Rainforest. He's going to fall down to 19, and he'll play a Delver's Secret. Which land does Jim want to get? He's going to go with Underground Sea.
That sets up Jones, if he wants it, for the line of Daze your Delver, untap Wasteland you.
You missed Legacy, didn't you?
I do. I
everything in my
right now, I am having a recollection of some of the best years of my life. Right now. Yeah.
There is a daze. He'll float a mana appropriately.
Jones putting the land into his hand where it is safe.
From
then on the battlefield, who knows?
Yep.
Anything can happen.
He'll now draw a card, picked up another daze.
So maybe you replay your land so you can daze the next. Oh, yeah.
And now there's.
Ha. We are getting this started right.
Yes, we are. And what people don't see, you even got the cup of coffee next to you.
Yep.
So you are really cooking right now.
Yeah, a couple turns in, just lands in the graveyard. No one's done anything.
Davis has picked up a copy of Stifle, so at least he has one on the draw.
Memories. Ooh. Yeah, so now he can play his fetchland and hope to stifle.
Yeah. Conceal that wasteland.
Or does he just need to cast a cantrip because he can't afford to let the mana burn off?
That's true. He's going to play a ponder.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I like it. Gotta cast something.
Gotta
because that land is not long for this world.
Might not be here a while.
Make it count. Yeah, get one spell. Make it count.
Tropical Island is a land that Jim has elected to search up. Here comes the ponder for Davis. Days, Stifle, and a Polluted Delta are the cards that he's looking at. He'll consult the grip. We see the Stifle in his hand already. We know he's got a Wasteland over there. Baleful Strix, too. I think he's got some interest in the Polluted Delta.
This is a nice set of cards here. It's another land, which is valuable just in its own right. And it's also the mana fixing to cast the Baleful Strix in hand. Mm-hmm. Taking the Days is fine protection for this turn since Jones has no mana in play. And he can shuffle away the Stifle or keep it as the game develops. So a really nice set of cards there for Davis to look at.
Yeah, leave him on top. He'll take the Days. He'll pass the turn back over to Kevin. Kevin will draw a card. Picked up a Lightning Bolt. Looks like he's going to play... Ooh. He's thinking Underground Sea.
Make it count.
Yeah, he's going to go with Delta now.
Make it count.
Yep. We're going to head back over to Jim. He'll untap that Tropical Island. Time for him to draw. Polluted Delta. We knew that was coming.
It's tough because Tropical Island and Underground Sea, Volcanic Island, they cost so much money, mm-hmm. but you can't get sentimental about them.
Because they're just going to die so much.
They're just going to die.
Yep. Kevin, ooh, not going to sacrifice the fetch land. Okay.
Well, if you're not going to sacrifice it on your main phase, you're not going to sacrifice it in the face of the mana.
Sure.
Keep your powder dry.
Yep. I'll just play Volcanic Island past the turn back.
Ooh, that wasteland is looking good.
It's a wonder you play Burner Legacy when you get so much enjoyment of seeing people have their lands killed.
That's why I only play with basic lands.
Oh, sure. and no fetches.
No fetches, yeah. Only basics. Yeah.
Now, Davis could have sacrificed that land.
No, he's on a plan here. Yeah, he's going to get a wasteland, that volcanic. That other stifle's coming up for sure.
Okay. There is that wasteland. Pass the turn back. Oh, I think we're going to see it on the upkeep.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's the upkeep wasteland. See you later, Volcanic Island.
How many mana-producing lands are in Jones's deck? This is important.
Let's take a count here. Kevin got to play an Underground Sea. He's got two Trops, two Volcanics, three Underground Seas, and if you want to count Wasteland, we can. Four of those.
That sort of counts.
Yeah.
But not for the purposes of... Ooh, that's a big draw there from Davis.
Yeah, Death Rite's nice.
Because it allows him to play a card onto the battlefield mm-hmm. and also have Stifle up.
Yeah.
That's a big gain right there.
Death Rite Shaman also good because there are lands in the graveyard.
Yes.
A lot of those.
Quite a few.
A lot of those shortage.
Yeah. That is not going to be a bottleneck for Death Rite Shaman in this game. That is for sure.
Jim will sacrifice Polluted Delta, fall down to 17, get himself an Underground Sea. I think we're going to see that Death Rite Shaman now. And we will. That's good. Jones. See if he's going to sacrifice his fetch line. He could just go towards Murderer's Cut, too. He's got one of those in his hand.
I think Jones is trying his best to play around the stifle here. He's been sitting here for a while.
Mm-hmm. But it's fun. It's this little game inside the game where you're playing as one of your teammates. You know what they're playing because you have the deck list. And you probably know their tendencies and if they leave Stifle in or not.
And beyond that, with Davis leaving up a mana here while he's missing land drops, it's a big cost for him to leave up this Stifle. Mm-hmm. There's part of Kevin that probably doesn't want to let him off the hook. But Jones's hand needs raw mana and colored mana, so he's got to force the issue at a certain point.
Here is Stifle.
Storm count.
Yeah, let's...
Oh, okay, we're floating black mana.
Yes, we are. No storm to be had here. Days will take care of the Stifle. Now the fetch land is going to resolve. So Delta's going to search up a Volcanic. Curious to see if we'll see Lightning Bolt on the end step so that Kevin can be efficient with the mana, or... if we'll see him waits on tap. But he's going to fire it off now. And the daze is not going to counter. Jim's not going to protect.
Well,
I guess
Kevin
the black
man.
There's the black man.
Kevin's still got the mana
floating. So I take that back.
He's good.
Yep. There's Underground Sea. Kevin will just pass the turn back. Over to Davis we go. He's got two lands. He'll draw for the turn. He's picked up a Polluted Delta.
And you can see why Baleful Strix is a pretty nice card to have post-board. It's just, the game is just about raw resources. A lot of cards just trade, and a two-for-one, even one that looks kind of anemic, is still really potent.
Davis suggests a Polluted Delta. We'll head back over to Jones. He's picked up a copy of Brainstorm. He'll play Misty Rainforest. So for as much fun as the early stages of this game was with Wastelands and Stifles and all of the posturing, dare I say players are flooding at this point.
Well, Jones plays this sort of game a lot better than Davis does.
Oh, I totally agree. Here's a Brainstorm.
More powerful threats, more card advantage. He's also got Life from the Loam probably in his deck somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And that definitely has the potential to lock Davis out.
Davis has picked up another Baleful Strix, among others, as he's brainstorming. Disfigure looks like it's going to go back. Strix on top of that, and we will probably see Polluted Delta get sacrificed as well. No, he will just untap. Now he'll take a draw, pick up the Strix. Going to be to Delver of Secrets he goes. The thought process here might be I'd like to leave an instant on top of my deck for the Delver to transform.
Still has the option to shuffle away if he doesn't want it.
Mm-hmm. Abrupt Decay, excuse me, the draw here for Kevin. And now here's a Flooded Strand for Jones as well. So he's got plenty of lands to operate with. And it looks like Kevin actually has a Snapcaster Mage in his hand, too. He's got three of those.
Yeah, another card that allows him to play a better long game once he can get to that point.
The Delver trigger. Reveal a Disfigure. Jones is facing down a 3-2 flyer right now. Davis thinking about sacrificing the Delta before he actually draws the Disfigure. And it looks like he is leaning towards sacrificing the Delta, and he will. That's going to resolve. Jim will fall down to 16.
Remember, deck lists are public here, and Davis just needs to get something going. He's got to know that Jones has a better late game if it gets to that point.
Yep.
And he can't just sit around with situational removal in hand hoping that Jones produces something that he can disfigure.
Underground Sea here for Jim. He'll be drawing a card for his turn here in just a moment. Shuffle the Disfigure away, which means he is not interested in that card at this stage. Now, you can see Kevin Jones's hand. He's got removal spells lined up. He's got a Snapcaster Mage. And he's got a Trinity Nemesis, and he really wants to slide that into play. Here's an attack for 3. See where Jones wants to go here to take care of the 3-2. Looks like he's considering Murderous Cut. So he'll target the Delver of Secrets. He's going to pay the delve cost. He's going to delve 4 away. So it'll just cost a single black mana at this stage. Potentially a little shrinking of Tarmogoyfs here.
Jones also just putting a premium on being able to win counter wars against spell pierces and dazes and stifles on his fetch lands. He doesn't want to get involved in that kind of fight with Davis. Davis plays that game a lot better. So it's a little weird to see him what looks like overpaying in this spot, but you just don't know the arrangement of cards Davis can have to fight back against this if you, say, tap the Volcanic Island as well and leave a card in the graveyard.
Yeah. And those fetch lands are very real resources when you have Ponder and Brainstorm in your deck.
Yep.
Don't really want to let those go.
Especially in a game like this that looks like it's settling in to be on the longer side.
Todd Stevens, Brad Carpenter. Looks like they're going to game number 3. Stevens on Shardless Sultai. Carpenter on 4-color Delver himself.
Davis showing a lot of patience here. His hand's getting a little bit bottlenecked. And again, with the deck list being available, knowing about Jones having what I believe to be a better late game, I wonder if Davis just has to start casting these Baleful Strixes just to get enough resources to work with.
Well, this might force interaction. Because there's a Deathrite Shaman.
I mean, this is a nice and easy spot for Abrupt Decay if Davis wants it. It's not doing anything with the mana otherwise. He can still leave up his one mana for Stifle.
The very powerful Elf Shaman.
Just concerned about Davis spending too many turns not using his mana. He's been playing kind of this reactive game. He has not been super efficient with his mana, and I think in this matchup there's a real premium on mana efficiency, especially on Davis's side. He needs to be the aggressor.
Well, Replicate takes care of that. Brainstorm, the draw. I know he doesn't have a fetch land right now, but do you like firing off Brainstorm? Do you want to go to Baleful Strix?
I want to go to Baleful Strix right now.
Okay, well, Jim is being very patient. He doesn't want to do either. Wasteland.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We're back at it, huh?
Who knows?
We do have a result for you here, as Jones will just pass the turn back. Bradley Carpenter wins his match over Todd Stevens, 2-1. So the member of Team Next Ridge Nexus off to a nice start here for the well-dressed Todd Stevens. He starts his tournament off with a loss.
It looks like Davis is committed to trying to leave up Spell Pierce plus Stifle, and I think that's just too taxing on his mana here. I understand you would want to wait ideally till you had a fourth mana, but even the Wasteland doesn't count because you need blue, black, blue, blue to be able to Strix plus Stifle plus Pierce. Just got to cast something.
Yeah. Again, as I said during the sideboarding, and I still feel this way, the longer the game goes, the better it is for Kevin.
Absolutely.
Not Jim. Baleful Strix will draw days, and that's an example of why. The longer we go, the worse the card like that gets.
Yep. When we saw Davis win game one, it was essentially just get on top of Jones early on in the game and play more efficient Magic. That's, I think, where Davis gets his edge. Not this kind of game.
Jones going to activate Wasteland. Trying to pick his spot very carefully here. Going to go after that Underground Sea. Davis could Stifle, but if he Stifles, that means the shields are down. And Jones could do a lot over the next turn and a half.
Well, the shields are down regardless, because either he allows this Wasteland to resolve and loses his untapped blue mana, or he Stifles and then also loses his untapped blue mana. So now, finally, the coast is clear here for Jones to do whatever he wants to do. He's been sitting for a very long time on these fetch lands, has respected the possibility of Stifle, but now, finally, the coast is clear.
His patience has paid off. Here's a Brainstorm now. Here comes a lot of interaction, most likely. So you see Jim organizing the stack. In order to use Wasteland, you must sacrifice it, so that's why it's in the graveyard. Stifle is targeting the Wasteland. That was going after the Underground Sea, and Brainstorm has been placed on the stack on top of that. Davis with a daze in hand. And I think the very powerful instant will resolve. So Jones will draw a couple of cards, Wasteland among them.
Not really that interested in getting into a counter war here over this Wasteland if I'm Jones' side, because Davis could just dead it by dazing literally anything and picking the targeted Underground Sea back in his hand. So Jones wants to Brainstorm response. I'm fine with that, but I'm not looking to engage in a counterfight over this. I think you guys let this go. You kind of won the battle anyway, because now Davis is tapped out finally, and you can cast whatever it is you've been holding for the last set of turns.
Jones has found Wasteland.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to let that rip.
Love it.
Goodbye, Tropical Island. Now Jones is going to sacrifice a Flood of Strand, search up a land here.
So this I'm not a huge fan of from Jones's side, if he's going to True Name Nemesis, which I believe he's doing. I think I would have just played the Wasteland first, then cast the True Name so I can't get double dazed.
Okay.
Or if Davis wants a double daze, you can pay for it. And then if he doesn't double daze, you just Wasteland him after the fact.
I was going to say, you know, maybe you're fine being double dazed in this spot, but realistically, you can just turn that card off entirely.
Why bother?
Yeah.
Maybe you are, but there's no reason to have it matter.
Yep.
And especially in this matchup, if True Name resolves, I mean, Davis is
basically it.
At this spot with life tolls this high.
Yeah. Yeah. You're also working with Perfect Information, so you don't have to worry about a card like Golgari Charm.
I mean, there's the possibility that Davis has brought in his Marsh Casualties. Mm-hmm. You can't rule it out, I guess. But whatever, he's got one Marsh casualties. He can cast it anyway if he wants to. It's, yep. That's not part of the decision tree here.
Well, 2 dazes will take care of Trini Nemesis. It's 4 lands to 0 currently, and Jim with the 1/1 flyer.
This is a battlefield I can respect.
Yes, yes it is. A ponder here for Davis. That's the draw step. He'll start by attacking for 1. Jones will fall down to 15, and now here is Ponder. That'll resolve. Tarmogoyf is 1, Delver is 2, and Tropical Island is 3. That's a pretty good Ponder.
That's a really good-looking set of cards right there. Mm-hmm. 2 threats plus green mana. That looks about perfect to me, and I like Davis here. I think taking the Trop, drawing the Tarmogoyf as the next card, and then having the Delver down there on a potential blind reveal, but whatever. Green mana plus 2 threats is about as good as you can draw up here for that Ponder.
A fun tweet here from Tom Ross. I've never played a game with my Legacy deck before. Tom is in game number 3. His Legacy weapon of choice here this weekend is lands.
That is a surprise.
Yes. He is going to game number 3 right now against Andrew Jessup, who is playing Elves, a deck that he's played a lot in Legacy.
Lands is a very angle-shooting style of deck. Little dangerous to play in a field with Caleb.
This is true. This is true. Here's another Baleful Strix. Jim will draw a card. He will confidently attack there with the Strix. Check with the Delver, Will Jones. He has drawn a Polluted Delta. You can see his hand of Snapcaster Mage, Lightning Bolt, and Abrupt Decay. And he'll just attack with the Delver now.
Imagine a quick block here. Davis way ahead on cards. Okay.
Maybe not. He'll just take 1. Davis will draw now. He's found a tropical island. That draw was forceful. He was hoping for something in particular, I believe. Davis is actually in pretty good shape for how long this game has gone. I thought things would get a lot worse.
I guess the logic there for no blocks is if Jones drew nothing, drew a land, then Jim is probably comfortable racing, given how threat dense his deck is. And if Jones drew a creature, which is a possibility, Davis might prefer to have an extra Strix back as a blocker for something like Gurmag Angler.
Well, there's a Delver, and here's a Tarmogoyf, and all of a sudden, this game is looking pretty difficult for Kevin Jones.
I mean, he's got Snapcaster plus Abrupt Decay, and that does some work here.
This is a Lightning Bolt on the Delver. That's an Abrupt Decay.
But you can see it's just... these players, a lot of cards just trade 1 for 1, and these Baleful Strixes are great in that kind of game.
Very much so.
Trades with everything is worth 2 cards for sure if it resolves.
Kevin going to come across here for 1. The follow-up is Deathrite Shaman. Last card in hand is a Snapcaster Mage.
We have our first moment of encroachment.
Yes,
in
an encroachment penalty.
Jim pushed it back. He resolved it himself.
He'll play another land here. 2 Underground Seas, 2 Tropical Islands here for Davis. Might be thinking Dark Confidant now. And he is. The follow-up is Deathrite Shaman. Now Jim wants to get aggressive again. In for 2. Jones down to 10. Baleful Strix has looked very, very good this game. We're going to head back over to Kevin. Check in with the Delver. Flusterstorm. Does he want to keep that, though? He's got a Delta in play.
I would want to shuffle this away.
Yeah?
But Jones just has so many powerful cards in his deck. And I think the ship has sailed for Flusterstorm to be any good, especially if Davis knows about it. Then it's very hard to convert into a card at this stage.
Well, he agrees with you. He's going to sacrifice the Polluted Delta. Search up a tropical island. Fall down to 9 in the process, will Kevin. But he's in some trouble here. Now Kevin will draw. Didn't get a great look. But he's tapping mana on his main phase, so it must have been something relevant. He's going to go to Snapcaster Mage, however. Use the red mana to do so. Curious what he's going to target
here. I think he wants to get Abrupt Decay back.
Okay. What's he want to kill?
Probably Dark Confidant.
Okay. That's what he's going to target. Can't spell pierce that. And now here's an attack for 3 in the air. Davis is going to fall down to 11. We are in an interesting racing situation. As Davis will untap. Now it's time to draw. Picked up a Delver to go along with a Brainstorm and a Spell Pierce. Davis has been holding that Brainstorm for some time here, Patrick.
Well, I think he's just waiting for... I think as long as the game looks close, Davis does not want to fire off this Brainstorm when he's not in a position to improve his hand. Now with the game getting tight, he might be a little bit more inclined to do it, but I think he wants to wait until he draws a fetch land or his hand can somehow be improved. For the time being, there's no rush.
His spot is still somewhat advantageous.
Yep, and you can do better with a Brainstorm.
Jones is going to activate his Deathrite Shaman. Looks like he's going to go after Abrupt Decay. And
trying to think who's the originator of the quote. I think maybe it's AJ Soccer, but Brainstorm's so good that you can't cast it.
Yes. Yes.
And I get that feeling that's kind of the perspective that Davis has right now.
Just hold steady.
Just too good to cast. You can do a lot better down the line if the game gets close.
Ponder the draw here for Kevin. That's a good one. You mentioned he's got a lot of good ones to draw to, so he'll play a Ponder.
You can see these Baleful Strixes are causing Jones all sorts of problems here. I mean, they are worth a full card on the table, and Jones just doesn't have the resources to be bolting and Abrupt Decaying these things away.
Well, Kevin just kept with his Ponder real fast. Delver is what he drew. There are two Lightning Bolts beneath that. Here comes Snapcaster Mage, it looks like. Looks like Delver Secrets, too. Gotta imagine Baleful Strix, yeah, is going to jump in front of the Flyer. There's the trade. Davis will take 2. He'll fall down to 9. 9-6 in favor of Jim right now. Jones will play a Delver. And now he'll play a Deathrite.
And now with Jones's hand empty, you might see Davis Brainstorm now because it's worth so much to guarantee a Delver flip. Like, the skies are clear. Mm-hmm. Jones has no hand, and he's at 6.
Yep.
So this 3 points is really valuable, and now I think you're going to see the Brainstorm.
There it is. 1, 2, and 3. There are some big draws here from Jim Davis. Vendilion Click might classify as one.
Yeah, nothing wrong with Click here. I mean, another Flyer.
You got to be a little worried about the death rites over there, but while Jim is tapped out, Kevin, I think, wants to gain some life.
Yep, that sounds right to me.
So he goes reaching for Tropical Island. He'll remove a creature. He's going to go up to 8. Time's starting to become a little bit of a factor here. Spell Pierce in hand, that's going to transform the Delver. Remember, the other Deathrite Shaman here for Jones is not active. And Jim might just get aggressive with both creatures. This will be interesting.
I mean, the skies are clear and not great attacks here on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And still with Abrupt Decay plus a Vendilion Click ready to go in case the Delver flips or Snapcaster somehow becomes a valuable attacker. With being outclassed on the 2 Deathrite Shamans to 1 and a lot of resources to work with, I think Davis does have to be the aggressor here.
He's just got to try to get the game over with. Here's an attack for 3. Jones is going to fall down to 5. Okay, Jim's got that Abrupt Decay. He's got a Vendilion Click, a Spell Pierce that he revealed. And now Jones will untap. We know the top card's Lightning Bolt. How does that change things for Jim is the question.
I mean, Jones is in this really weird spot of he's kind of playing defense right now, but he could flip and kill Davis really fast. Mm-hmm. I mean, Davis is at 9 here. 2 Deathrite Shamans to 1.
Here come the knuckleheads.
And Jones kind of getting the best of both worlds here. If Davis wants to try to damage race, then Jones can go ahead and just gain life and try to manage it that way. And if Davis wants to trade here, then he can just gun him out with the Deathrite Shamans as well.
Yep.
So Davis is in this weird squeeze of he needs to maintain enough offense to make sure that Jones can't just pivot and burn him out with the Deathbringer Shamans.
Looks like Baleful Strix wants to get in front of something. And they might see the Abrupt Decay now, too. Maybe. Jim a little unsure. Make a more simplistic block. But does he want to take two from the Snapcaster?
I think he's got to get this Deathrite Shaman situation back to parity.
That's where the Decay goes?
I think so.
Okay. He's down to seven.
He could also Vendilion click here.
Well, he is.
Forces the hand on the Lightning Bolt.
Mm-hmm. Because presenting lethal.
Yep.
I'm curious where Jim wants to target. Targeting yourself is somewhat appealing here. Spell Pierce is not doing much.
Yes.
Kevin's going to bolt there. Yep. And now Jim. This will be interesting. A little game of chicken here.
Right. Because Deathrite Shaman's a little funky. You can play over the top of a Deathrite with your own.
Yeah. Kevin going to go up to seven.
Although Davis has some agency here. If he removes a spell, then Jones can't, you know, remove the creature to fizzle in response. He has to remove a spell.
And daze the draw. This is an attack for three. Jones is going to fall down to four. I think you start with the Abrupt Decay on the untapped Deathrite Shaman. Perhaps?
I think you just hold tight for a turn.
Wow, okay.
Because you can always respond.
Jones wants to remove a little something here. And Davis, will he let that happen?
No, I can't imagine.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a four-point swing here.
Yep.
Now I think you might see the Abrupt Decay.
Yep. However, I still think this leads to Kevin winning. Lightning Bolt on top of the deck.
Which Davis does not know about, for
correct.
The record.
Here's the attack for two. That brings Jim down to five. Here's a Deathrite Shaman activation. That brings him down to three. That's going to resolve. And now here's a Lightning Bolt. Spell Pierce and Daze are not going to be enough to get the job done. So Kevin Jones is going to tie things up here against Jim Davis. Four-color Delver and Saltite Delver getting ready here for game number three. We felt that if things got long like that, it would favor Kevin, but it was a lot closer than I thought it would be.
Yep. I mean, Jones able to kind of just win the battle over Deathrite Shaman, just a little bit more efficient in those spots. The second copy was huge, and a perfect ponder there, being able to find that Delver of Secrets plus two bolts. Because the game was in this really weird spot of maybe Jones is playing defense, maybe Jones is playing offense. He's kind of responsive to his draw steps. And Lightning Bolt was perfect because it allowed him to play offense and defense as the game required.
Well, these players are going to shuffle up here for game number three very, very quickly. We can learn a little bit about Kevin Jones if you'd like.
Absolutely.
The man, the myth, the legend, the 29-year-old from Kingstown, New York, with 10 open top eights and 2 open wins. He qualified via Season 2 as one of our points leaders. Great record over the course of the year. And one thing about Kevin, he plays a lot of Magic.
Yes, and 2016 has been a really good year. It kind of started last year at the Players' Championship with a bit of a Cinderella run. I think Jones came in with relatively low expectations and had a great run. Tremendous 2016. Got to represent Team USA at the World Cup and was one of the fixtures of the SCG Tour, now back at the Players' Championship.
Here he is. He's back at it again. And now these players are going to have to get rocking and rolling here. We know they're going to play pretty quickly. And Jim will be on the play here for this.
And you see these players speed up.
Yep. Kevin, not happy with his hand. He'll mulligan very, very quickly. Jim happy enough with his. The results are rolling in again. Make sure you're following at SCG Live so you can see all the live updates. Nick Miller is going to be on the floor all weekend long. He'll be providing you with those. We got plenty of deck techs here for you guys as well over the course of the weekend across all three formats. And you can hashtag SCGPC all weekend long and join in on the conversation with myself, with Patrick, Matthias, Ryan, and Nick. Kev will scry top to bottom to Jim. He'll slam in Delver. Gonna search up an underground sea, and that's not there anymore.
The Wasteland Wall Behind is one of my favorite plays in League.
On the Mulligan too.
I just hope you can't play.
Yep. Look, it's reasonable.
Oh,
reveal stifle, huh? Does Jim have another land? He does. He's got plenty of lands.
Pretty
he's an attack for
lucky.
Three.
Yeah.
Any follow up here for Davis? He's gonna sacrifice a land right now.
Yeah, he wants to be able to hold this up and not need to sacrifice his fetch land in response and then give a window for Jones to be able to ignore the stifle.
Ponder time.
I think this is sort of the recipe you want if you're Davis, and sort of a repeat so far of the first game of getting ahead on the battlefield early and being ahead on mana and hope that Jones just never gets an opportunity to leverage his more powerful cards.
Kevin has lands. Ponder's done resolving. We're going to head over to Jim. Jim will draw, picked up a disfigure, in for three yet again. It's one of these type of games, or at least that's what Jim wants it to be.
Yeah.
A very Delver-centric game.
Lean and efficient. Cheap spells. This is where Davis has a pronounced advantage.
He'll search up an Underground Sea, play a Dark Confidant, pass the turn back. You can see Jones's hand. Two Ponders, a Delver, and just lands. One of them is a Wasteland. He's going to play an Underground Sea. And now it's Ponder, maybe on the search for a Lightning Bolt.
Yeah, Lightning Bolt would be ideal here.
Top couple of cards here for Kevin. Don't think I see a Lightning Bolt in those three, but he will keep. He's taking a Brainstorm. There's Delver.
I don't know about... I didn't get a look at the full top three there,
mm-hmm.
but they have to be real damn good if it's not Lightning Bolt to not shuffle there.
Yeah.
He is just getting run out right now. And you have to imagine Jim can... You can't really bank on this Delver because it has to flip immediately and survive. I suppose if Jones left on top, it's because he knows the Delver will flip. But I think that's asking a lot here.
Well, there's the attack for five. Jones down to nine. And Jim is going to keep extending into this board, play a Delver, pass the turn back. I know he'd like to leave up Stifle, but I don't think it's time for that.
No.
I think Diabolic Edict may have been the draw.
And there's the summary right there. You know, Jones is just not good at playing this sort of lean game.
Mm-hmm.
He's paying two mana to answer things that deal one, or that cost one and have already dealt damage.
And Jim is happy to sacrifice the Delver. Kevin going to play a Ponder now too. Top couple of cards here for Jones. I think I saw a Lightning Bolt in there.
The problem is too little too late. Same thing as game one. Jones got behind. Davis got multiple threats onto the battlefield, and Jones could only manage one a turn.
Mm-hmm. Baleful Strix, that's going to complicate things a little bit here for Kevin. There's a Brainstorm as well. For Jim, he'll attack for five yet again. Jones going to fall down to four, and I think he's just going to go straight to Tarmogoyf, which
exactly.
I like.
Yeah. Yep. Just whatever the most power for my mana is, that's yep. what I'm casting this turn.
It's a 4-5 Tarmogoyf there for Davis. He'll pass the turn back over to Jones. Jones has picked up a copy of Murderous Cut. It's not over just yet.
But can he answer everything?
The Tarmogoyf die. Looks like Tarmogoyf's going to be leaving here in just a moment.
Yeah. Don't get sentimental. But he's got to be able to also stay. You know, if he, let's say he kills the Dark Confidant and mm-hmm. the Tarmogoyf, he can't crack a fetch land.
Yep.
And that starts becoming a factor here, too.
Well, there's Bolt.
And I think the reason he has to bolt that instead of the Confidant is because he needs that Floodstrand and has to go to two and then one to have a shot.
There's Cut.
But when your opponent's stalled on two lands with a Confidant play, you know it's all spells.
Yep.
And Jones can only answer on a one-for-one basis right now.
And he's seen some of the spells in Tarmogoyf and Baleful Strix as the reveals. Now, This will be a brainstorm. Now, if he brainstorms into something useful here, we change things a little bit. Delta is 1, strand is 2, decay is 3. I think, yeah, 2 fetches probably go back. Keep wasteland, which you obviously approve of.
Mm-hmm.
And decay, which is plenty fine. Pass the turn back. Dark Confidant trigger. Brainstorm. Davis down to 12. I know he's just looking for that third land. Makes it a little bit easier. Hasn't found it yet, though. Here comes Bob. Jones down to 2. We saw him play Tarmogoyf last time in this situation. I'm curious to see if we see that again here from Jim.
I still like Tarmogoyf here. I don't like the Brainstorm. I understand. You're a little frustrated. You wish you had a third land. But this is just good. Yep. Yeah. Just do this.
Yep.
You don't even have to worry about True Name Nemesis.
Yep. There is Tarmogoyf. Jones will sacrifice the fetch line. He's going to fall down to 1. There is a combination of cards that can do it here for Kevin. Let him keep playing.
Well, I think that True Name Nemesis plus Abrupt Decay is a path.
Really good. Yeah.
Although if Davis is sharp about it, he can just daze the True Name Nemesis and there's not enough mana to work.
If he has a daze in hand.
Right.
That's the question. Jones will draw a card. It's a fetch line. That's going to do it. Jim Davis going to win this match here over Kevin Jones. 2-1. The player's champion. He wins his first match with Salt-Eyed Delver, defeats his good friend and teammate Kevin Jones in his four-color Delver deck, and Jim Davis, our defending champion, off to a great start.
A little bit leaner and more efficient. We saw that.